chose the way you were going to animate these characters?
I think with Young Justice, well, first of all, I was lucky enough to get asked to design DVD for Warner's a couple years ago. Friends of mine, Lauren Montgomery and Sam Blue, asked me to do Crisis on Two Earths, and you know, Bruce Timm liked my stuff enough to give me a shot. So that stuff kind of, I think, you know, was kind of floating around the studio, and they wanted to develop Young Justice, so I kind of, you know, it was the right time. I really got lucky with the timing on that, and it was like, you know, I never thought I'd be designing these iconic superheroes. You know, I thought I could have like a great career and everything, and you might never get a shot at touching them. I think something that Danica just said about, you know, having the chance to participate in such a grand tradition, really. And when you talk about the DC characters, specifically in animation, I mean, it goes back all the way to the Fleischer Brothers Superman stuff, you know. But then you have so many great artists, you know, getting, you know, doing their take on the characters, like Alex Toth, and of course, you know, modern masters like Bruce and James Tucker and Glenn Murakami and all these guys. So to get a crack at it at all was kind of incredible. But when it came to Young Justice, Brandon and Greg have a really specific sort of world that they're trying to create. Like, they create like the backstory and the context for everything. I mean, so much of it is pulled from the lore and the history of the DC characters, but it all has to be sort of you know, adapted and sort of, you know, manipulated to a certain degree to fit into the context of the world. So I think there's a practical approach to design in the show that Brandon and I talk about a lot, which, you know, it forces you to think in terms of, like, we can't just look in the old DC, you know, who's who encyclopedias and just draw the character straight off the page. We have to really think about, you know, to a certain extent, how it would actually, you know, fit into a more realistic or practical world. So I think there's a lot of thought that goes into that. We have a lot of discussions about it, like story, you know, comes first, context. These guys spend a lot of time trying to create the context and the backstory for everything. And that sort of dictates the design direction.
What about managing the volume? There are so many characters, so many heroes, so many villains. What's that like?
My producer, David Wilcox, is right over there. It's his job to manage the volume. And he's really mean to us.
I was going to say he's a wonderful human being. He puts up with it. I love him. But it's challenging. I, you know, fortunately, I'm not above just complaining until I get the help that I need. So I have an incredibly talented design team that helps me with it. And I try to break things up according to strength, you know. But it's a lot of conversations with Brandon and Greg and figuring out the mechanics and, like, you know, how much we can sort of tweak characters without breaking them. I mean, these are icons for the most part. I mean, there's a 70-plus year history now with the DC characters. So you have to kind of walk a fine line. You know, you really want to be faithful to the rich tradition, but, you know, we absolutely have to do something that's unique to us and what we're doing now. We just, by virtue of the fact that all the guys that came before us, they got there first. So we really have to sort of reimagine these characters. We can't just do, you know, it's like, you don't want to try to compete with that stuff. So you kind of have to, you know, create new rules in order to do your own thing. And it's been incredible. But yeah, managing the volume is difficult. And, you know, we do our best. We don't always, you know, it's not a perfect system, but, you know, luckily.
Well, the end result is working out.
Thank you.
I'm going to ask these guys one more question, and then if you guys want to start lining up, if you've got any audience questions. And part of it feeds into what Phil was talking about the rich history. But there are some newer characters, particularly Miss Martian. She's a relatively new character in the DC Universe. So talk about the spin you guys put on her versus the... I mean, you had a limited history to work with from the comics, so how is she different, similar? Talk about that.
Well, we sort of had to go back and think
think about Mars in general. And I went back to some of the really early Martian Manhunter appearances before he was the last Martian. And it felt more interesting to me, frankly. It felt like him becoming the last Martian felt like him cribbing off of Superman a little bit. Like, Superman's last Kryptonian is one of the things that makes him special, and the need for John Jones to be the last Martian didn't seem essential to his character. It seemed like a later addition. So we went back to the idea of a populated Mars, a Mars that's divided by racial strife, which is something I think is really relatable to everyone in our audience. Ms. Martian refers to that in this episode. And so we've got a Martian sort of caste system up there, and that plays into how we thought about McGann and what Danica brings to the character, because she knows all the backstory, even if I won't let her tell you. And that helped inform who she was.
Okay, first question, what's your name?
Connor, and my favorite John Jones character is Superboy.
What a surprise.
And I was wondering, could you do a Green Lantern episode featuring the whole Corps?
And just one note about questions too. Spoilers, we don't want to ruin it for the upcoming stuff, so try and keep your questions to what we've already seen or what the process has been, because these guys really want to keep this story unfolding at a mysterious pace so that you guys can enjoy it as it's revealed. So just to keep that in mind as you ask the questions.
Wow, no pressure.
No pressure at all.
Nice work on Martin and Wendy. That was really fun, and loved having that. Do you guys have any other cool throwbacks like that that you have planned that's not spoiler in any way, shape, or form?
I don't mind telling you, I love the HP characters. I grew up on Super Friends. That was my introduction to the DC Universe. I love them all dearly.
Keep watching.
I was wondering if you're going to show Wonder Woman and Wonder Girl?
Well, we've already shown Wonder Woman a couple times, and briefly, and she'll be playing a larger role as the season progresses. But again, no spoilers, so I'm not going to talk about Wonder Girl. So.
And is there going to be more relationship lifetime between Connor and...
Yes. I like how they're all kneeling before us. Is that on purpose?
Are you coming to
the Astor? I am. Today I am.
Especially seeing this crowd here. Thank you guys for coming out.
I would actually like to shout out to a few other people on our staff. If you're on the Young Justice crew or cast, if you stand up, we want to point you out, make fun of you.
Dusty, stand up, buddy. Come on, take a bow.
Great top for all your hard work, everybody.
One, I love the show.
from the
Well, I certainly feel that I relate to Megan.
I don't know if there's one in particular that I relate to. I think they're all, you know, so well written that you can identify with all of them. Personal favorites, probably Robin, Aqualad, the whole main cast, really. I mean, all the relationship dynamics in the show are so good that, you know, it's impossible to really pick. So I love all our characters.
I'm gonna say Raish. I like to stick with that. I like to keep in the dark and you know, plot things for you guys.
Creepy. I was gonna say Lex Luthor, but it doesn't seem as funny now that he said that.
And I baked you guys some cookies.
Thank you. Thank you.
Next question.